Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 202 of the RRBG podcast. This podcast is a proud member of the Podbelly Network. Go to podbelly.com and check out all the amazing shows we have on our network, including the Sofa King podcast, Robots for Eyes, Art and Jacob Do America. I mean, there's one for everything that you're into. If you're into Magic the Gathering, they got you. If you're into the occult, they got you. You're into serial killers, they got you. Everything. Go to podbelly.com, check out the list, and support the network. I know by now you're probably tired of listening to me talk about Sheath underwear. But there's a reason for it. I wear them all the time. I'm wearing them right now. They're the most comfortable underwear I've ever had. And like I've said before, they have this pouch in the front for your balls. But guess what? If you're feeling weird about putting your balls in a pouch, use the pouch for other things. There's an array of different things you can put in there. For example, your wallet, hand sanitizer, your passport, a lighter, and some joints, a lemon, Mexican peyote muscle gel. The point is, they're incredibly comfortable and convenient. And if you go to sheathunderwear.com and you can use my promo code RRBG, you'll save 20%. Go there right now, support the company, which is owned by a veteran, and support us in the process. It's a win-win. This episode is also brought to you by Killcliff. My friends over at Killcliff make the best energy drink you can buy in the market today. Clean energy, none of that crap that they put in Monster or any of those Red Bulls. No sugar, just clean power for all the grind you're going to have to put in today. And if you're not grinding today and you just want to relax, they also have CBD drinks to help you recover from any injuries you may have, any kind of inflammation. Maybe you went a little too hard at the gym. CBD drink will get you right back on track. Go to their website, killcliff.com. Check out all their different flavors. My personal favorite Ignite drink is the cherry limeade. And in the CBD category, you have to try the Joe Rogan special. It's the Flaming Joe pineapple with jalapeno. It's not that spicy. You just get a little bit of a kick at the end. It's delicious. Go to killcliff.com and tell them that RRBG sent you. This podcast is also brought to you by Saints Joints. Go to saintsjoints.com and check out all the awesome products they have there, including the new Book of Saints. Saints that comes with four packs of pre-rolled joints. It's this incredible, lavish, luxurious looking gold foil stash box. The works. It's the best looking stash box I've seen. Make sure to go pick one up before they're all gone. And also check out the new hash infused pre-rolls. Don't forget, it's saintsjoints.com, and make sure you tell them that we sent you. In this episode, I talked to Sean Dowdell of Gray Daze. If you're not familiar with Gray Daze, it was actually the first band that Chester Bennington of Linkin Park had. Chester actually had reunited the band prior to his death and started working on new music with them. So they put together all the recordings of his vocal performances and recorded new instrumentation to it to put it out. They just recently released a EP called Amends Stripped, which is an acoustic version of some of those songs. And if you listen to the conversation we just had, they're currently working on another album with some of Chester's original performances as well. We talk about that. We talk about where the inspiration came to put something out like this. We talk about his other business venture with Chester, Club Tattoo, and we talk a bit about tattoo culture. It was a fun conversation. I hope you guys enjoy it. Don't forget to follow the band at Gray Daze or at Official Gray Daze. Pick up the EP Amends Stripped that just came out January 29th. And please check out our Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/RRBG. Cheers.
I will be waiting with a song in my soul. A fortunate weakling, which I have foretold. He raises his arms tied above the
What's up, everyone? Welcome to the RRBG podcast. I'm here with Sean Dowdell. Am I saying that right? Dowdell?
Yeah.
Dowdell?
Either one's fine.
Either one's fine. Of Gray Daze, how are you, sir?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on today.
For sure. You are you at work? You look like you're at work.
Yeah, I'm in my office in Arizona today.
Ah, how's Arizona doing with the whole pandemic lockdown? I don't even know where everybody's in different situations where, like, LA is completely shut down, but Texas is wide open. Where are you guys at in Arizona?
We're pretty much wide open. Yep. No, we've got high numbers, but The economy is open and businesses are open and we're able to function.
Actually, yeah, I think I just heard there are like comedy shows going on. Are there any concerts going on over there?
No, not yet. I think that's a few months away, but we're at least able to get out of our house and shop and go eat at restaurants or some, you know, stuff like that.
It's interesting how you can have a comedy show but not a rock show. I mean, what do they think is the difference there? You know, I mean, I guess the moshing, but I don't know. I think we could still have some shows separated out.
I agree. I want to see that stuff end quickly.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. You know, with the newly, you know, the rolling out of the vaccine and everything, I think we're definitely on track to getting back to some kind of live situation soon, right?
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah. You guys recently, January 29th, you put out Amends Stripped, which is an EP it's a rearrangement of the songs that were released in the Amends LP I think it was in June of last year. Or I forget when it was, or maybe January.
It was June.
June? Okay, I was right there. But so this new arrangement, tell me a little bit about it. Like, where did the idea come from to do that?
So initially, Tom, the CEO of the label, asked us if we had any B-sides for different packaging options. And basically, their retail distribution partners like Target, Walmart, countries like Japan, they like to have their own version of your record. They print it there. Target likes to have something different about your record to drive retail sales through their distribution centers, if that makes sense. So they want to have at least one track on the album that's different. So that's how the conversation started. He asking us about B-sides, and we showed him some different versions that we had of the tracks that we were doing, because we have such limited tracks with Chester being gone that we didn't want to use up another track from the next record. So we have these versions, these acoustic versions, and he said, these are good, let's use these. So that's how it started. Then once he sent us back in to East West Studio with Billy Bush and heard the final product, he said, these are really good, we should do a whole album of acoustic material. And I think the band was like, well, let's put out an EP, let's do, you know, five songs rather than the whole thing redone like this. Plus, we didn't have all those versions with a different performance from Chester. So, like, we just didn't want to use the same performance on every song. It just didn't feel right. So that's how it started. And then we went back in and added two more tracks, one called Shouting Out. And then we used an original version that we had recorded back in 97 with our original guitar player, Bobby Benish, where it was just us in a room recording with a couple microphones. There's no multi-track version. It's literally just a couple of mics mixed down to two-track live. So, I mean, it's not perfect. You're hearing some flub notes and just some dynamics that wouldn't be on a studio version. But I think it's a cool performance and captures a unique moment in time for us.
Yeah, and it also adds a level of like authenticity and rawness to have something like that, where you have like it's more human to hear like the flubs and stuff, like you said. Because I mean, sometimes super produced albums can sound a little fake or whatever, you know, a little empty or overproduced. And you know, I personally, you know, I'm a fan of listening to recordings like that, like on the spot, kind of live. So that's great. That's great to hear. So you kind of mentioned that you didn't want to use songs from another album. So are there more songs that you guys have in the works for possible, like, another album?
Oh, yeah. I apologize. Yeah. So we'll go back in the studio in April start recording the next record. We have enough material for at least one more album.
That's great. That's great. Back in the day when you guys were together in the beginning, and for anybody that's watching or listening that is not aware of what we're talking about, I can't imagine you're watching this episode and you haven't looked it up, but Chester Bennington of Linkin Park had Gray Days before Linkin Park started, and you guys were together for about 5 years and put together a bunch of music. You did some shows and stuff, but never actually put out albums? Is that the situation?
No, we put out records. We had record deals. We did really well. Okay. we put out two full-length albums Did a couple of different demos, and then we had three different record deals with the band. So the band was quite successful. We just didn't hit it big, and broke up right at the peak of the band. And then in 2016, Chester and I decided to put the band back together and go down that road again. And then unfortunately, he passed away before it all came to completion. But we started working on it while he was alive, and you know, we were very, very close friends, and it was just something that we were both very looking forward to doing and having fun with. And unfortunately, you know, it didn't get to happen while he was still here.
Yeah, it's a very tragic situation, and I, you know, I want to make it clear for anybody that's watching or listening too, because usually when something happens like this post-mortem, like, people try to, you know, the haters start talking crap about, like, oh, this maybe, like, this happened with, like, with Dio's wife. You know, it was a big situation with her putting out records post-mortem, and it's like, it's not some kind of, like, money grab situation. It's the family's behind it. Everybody's, you know, in the family is a part of it. I know you had the kids were a part of it as well, right? The vocal recordings.
One of his kids, Jamie, he sang backups on a track. You know, to that point, you're never gonna please everybody. And a lot of people that don't know my relationship with Chester, we are very, very close. He's one of my best friends in the world, and I definitely was one of his best friends in the world. We were business partners for 20 years in a company called Club Tattoo. I am a very successful business partner, entrepreneur. I'm a multimillionaire before any of this. So to say I'm chasing money, that's ridiculous. I think all total, you know, the band made a couple hundred thousand dollars, and that's divided by like 15 people, by the way. So if anything, I'm losing money on this proposition because of my day job not getting my full attention. So that, but you can't. The thing about that is you just can't argue with these internet warriors, man, because that's all they have time to do. They're in their parents' basement. They think they know what's going on. They have no clue. They don't know the band. They don't know the dynamics. They don't know the friendships. They don't know the music. But they have this gigantic predisposed opinion or determination about who you are or what you're doing. And they don't know shit. And I found myself for a while arguing with these trolls. And, you know, the time in my life where I would just show up and punch somebody in the face, that time's over. I'm 47 years old. I don't have time to argue with idiots.
Yeah.
So if you like our music, awesome. High five, hugs, we'll talk about it. If you don't, I don't care. Like, I just don't. I just don't have time for it. So that's really where, to that point, that's where that's at.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's important for people to look into certain things. They see Chester's name, they have their connection with, you know, what he did with Linkin Park, and then they feel some kind of ownership over it. It's like, dude, you don't know his personal life. You don't know what was going on before that. But I watched that you guys put out like a smaller, like a, it's kind of like a documentary. It's like a 10-minute video kind of explaining the whole situation and how everybody that was involved, you know, the families involved, the parents, the you know, his kid. And, you know, it's really beautiful. I think it's really great that you guys are fulfilling his dream to put out this music that he was working on, you know?
Well, look, to your point, those the people that talk badly, they don't know the situation. They don't know what he liked and what he didn't like. However, I do. I was one of his best friends in the world for a long time. So, you know, I don't find myself wanting to engage with that. And the music is good. If the music sucked and this wasn't something he wanted to do and I just picked it up out of the gutter after he passed away, I could kind of understand that, but that's not at all how it happened. And we did a 90-minute documentary that we'll be releasing really soon.
Oh, nice.
That explains it even more in depth than the people that were involved. But this whole project was done with nothing but love and trying to make sure that the integrity and the initial intention of what we set out to do together was honored. And Chester was a man of many talents. He wasn't just the singer in Linkin Park. He sang in Stone Temple Pilots. He sang in By Sunrise. He sang in Kings of Chaos. And he sang in Grey Days. He loved playing music. And the thing about Chester is if you knew him and you were in a room with him for more than 5 minutes and there was an instrument in the room, he would like heat seek his way to that instrument, pick it up and start playing. That's just who he was. He loved playing music with anybody and everybody. That's just part of his personality. So the people that think you can only compartmentalize him and put him in one section, well, fine. Then go listen to him in that genre. That's fine. Yeah. I'm a Chester fan and friend. So anything he did with the LP guys, I was proud of. Anything he did with Stone Temple Pilots, I was proud of. Anything he did with Dead by Sunrise, I was proud of. And, of course, I'm proud of the stuff he did with Great Ace. I think he's got a lot of talent in many different areas. And I don't think you have to have such a mutually exclusive identity with him. I just think that doesn't serve him well.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of people tend to – there's a lot of elitism in metal and rock music. Everybody's like, oh, you know, that's radio stuff. It's, you know, if it's radio stuff, they don't want to hear it. And it's like, you know, just enjoy music. Why does it have to be so, like you said, compartmentalized? Like, you just enjoy – if you're a fan of his and his voice, which was such a unique and powerful voice – why wouldn't you want to see the other stuff he was working on? You know, it's kind of ridiculous. And, you know, kudos to you for bringing that out and putting it out, because it would be a shame for someone whose entire life was dedicated basically to music to have stuff that no one gets to hear now, or just kind of disappears into the ether. You know, it's a beautiful thing, I think.
Well, thank you. Yeah. I'm very proud of it. And I think Chester would be very proud of it, too.
So you have enough for another album. No more after that, I'm assuming, that just because there isn't any recordings.
We'll see. There is a whole nother album worth of recordings that and some other stuff too, but we'll see. We'll see how this goes.
Okay.
You know, right now we're not trying to we're not trying to beat this thing to craziness. Like, we want it to feel organic and natural and right, and we're using the best of the songs that are available. You know, I don't really want to put out old demos that can't be polished or anything. That's not my goal with this, you know.
Now,
but I want the songs that are, in our opinion, great songs to see the light of day. And they haven't got that. So we got at least one more record, and it seems to be a demand for it right now. So we'll see how it goes.
That's good. That's good. If things were to go back to normal and we have live shows again, is that something that has been discussed, like potentially doing a live show, some kind of tribute show with maybe some friends doing vocals? Hopefully not any idea of doing a hologram tour, because, you know, power to everybody that does the hologram tours. I'm just not a fan of them.
I don't personally think the technology is there yet. Yeah. It'll get better. That would be a huge time suck for me to try to go up on stage and play to a hologram. That wouldn't feel right for me. We get asked a lot, and we've got some interesting offers. We love the idea of playing live, but the thing about it is it has to be done so carefully, and we have to be so cognizant of being respectful to Chester, not only him as our friend, but as his legacy. And there's a standard that his fans have of him that they want to make sure that we're not, you know, no disrespect to the people that are doing the holograms, because that's,
yeah,
they're obviously, some people want to see it because they're out there and they're going to see it. So once again, who am I to say don't do that? It's just not for me.
Right.
I don't see us doing a hologram. We would have to do some type of integration with some of his friends that would sing some of the stuff with him. We would never want to. My goal is, and I don't think the guys in the band either, we don't want to replace him. That's not the whole reason we did this was to do it with our friends. So then to come to the end of these recordings and then say, oh, we're going to replace him, that doesn't feel right. So it would have to be with some of his friends that would come up and sing, and we would do some type of integration with, you know, his original vocals and some video streaming. I don't know what it would look like. It's an interesting conversation, but it hasn't developed to the point of making it happen or taking action in it yet. But we'll see.
Yeah.
I know that's a really long answer to nowhere for you, and I'm sorry.
No, but, it's something. It's something. I think it would be cool to see, like, maybe not like a tour, but like one tribute show with a bunch of friends that, you know, that were close to him, that can try and do mimic his voice, which is hard to do. But I think that would be like a nice thing too, just for the fans and for everybody involved, all the friends and family. You know, it's like a heartwarming kind of. It's going to be emotional regardless, you know, just even being on at a live show at this point in time, because it's been a year since we've had concerts. But that, I mean, it would be a very powerful, I think, moment. So would you, I know that you were saying that you're a successful businessman on the side, like once you're done with all the material for Gray Days, is there, like, are you still interested in doing more music, maybe as a new project, or are you, this is it for you musically, and once this is done, you're going to just keep working?
That's hard to say. You know, if the right opportunity comes along, I would still play, because I've played with my friends for years, even before we decided to put Gray Days back together. So I think music's in my heart, my blood, and we'll see what happens. You know, I'll always jam with my friends, whether or not I try to take that seriously and put out a full produced record and stuff like that. That remains to be seen, but you never know. Yeah. You never know.
Tell me a little bit about Club Tattoo. Just, you know, how did that come together? What was the, like, the intention behind it?
Full transparency. Back in 1995, Mace, the original bass player for the band, and myself, the band was touring. We were doing these, like, what we would call satellite tours. We'd go out for like 4 or 5 days, and we'd play L.A., San Diego, San Francisco, or Denver, Dallas, Houston, just little satellite, little maybe 3-city tours, and then come back. And as we were doing that, we would go away for the time, and our bills would still be here when we got back. The band was doing well, but we weren't making enough money to support ourselves individually with the band money. It all went back into the recording budget or touring budget or whatever. And so we decided to open up a tattoo shop and try to supplement our income while we were on the road. That's the initial intention of Club Tattoo. Once we opened the store, turned out Mason and I were not good business partners. And within 6 months, I had to buy him out of the business. And then when Gray Days broke up in 98, I went on to another band and had another record deal and all this stuff. But I really, around that time, poured my heart and soul into my company and really blew it up and made it expand and just turned it into this bigger, I guess, global brand. A short version of it. But, you know, we expanded. We eventually went into Las Vegas. We have 6 studios now, three in Las Vegas, 3 in Arizona. We've done different global collaborations with brands like Oster and Edney's and Jardin and Bicycle and a lot of really cool things that have just really put our brand out into the global ether, even without the physical manifestations of studios in every city. Our brand is out there. And becoming partners with Chester in early 2003, I think, helped kind of catapult our company to that success.
I see. Yeah, I mean, I've seen the name around. It was kind of, you know, in the forefront of my, I guess, popular culture for a while there, you know, during the release of it and when Chester was around with Linkin Park and everything. So, you know, it's great to see that more love given to tattooing, because that always was such a, I guess, like, for example, I'll give you a personal story for you, but like the first tattoo I ever got, my family almost disowned me. You know, I got a tattoo on my arm because it was a very significant thing for me, just because it was something that I had seen, you know, during an outer body experience when I had a very bad car accident. I saw some shape and I was like, I need to remember this for the rest of my life. And when I showed up with it, I tried to explain that to, it was seen as like, oh, now you're a delinquent. now you're trash human. You know what I mean? And my father was the same way, where like he was always like, anybody that has a tattoo is a delinquent. And thankfully we've come to a point now where that's no longer the case, you know. I mean, unless you got some crazy...
I wish that were no longer the case, but maybe it's not in your family, but it's definitely, we're still fighting uphill battles in different arenas, you know, in the business world. I still have to have some uncomfortable conversations and win people over in the business world. But, you know, there's this predisposed attitude of what the tattooed lifestyle is and what social class is actually accepting of that. So, you know, I have conversations with, billion-dollar companies, and sometimes it's an uphill battle. But as time goes on, it's becoming a lot more socially accepted. And, of course, the TV shows and the sports figures and rock stars have made that, in my opinion, the reason that it is becoming more socially accepted in the workplace, in the business world.
Yeah, I you're right. I didn't really think about the business world, but I can imagine, you know, having to cover up or go into a meeting with like long sleeve, you know, up to the, unless you have finger tattoos or you know, face tattoos, then you're out of luck there. Yeah.
Wearing as a badge of honor at this point, and I have for years, you know, it's at this point, it's a competitive advantage for me, because I walk in and I get to articulate a position they don't expect me to be able to. You know, they look at me as a lowlife or not the intellectual level of what they're expecting. And I can hold my own in those arenas. And I'll sit down with a billionaire and be able to speak in a business format that they're like, okay, this guy actually is not an idiot. He knows what he's talking about. And it's easy for me most of the time to try to win the respect over in the business field. But it is a competitive advantage for me, because they don't see me coming. You know, it's.
Yeah. Yeah, I love that feeling. I love getting underestimated and then just kind of overperforming.
That's right.
That's always the best way to go about it.
That's exactly right. You come in and you kick their ass. And I don't mean physically. I just mean, like, they're not expecting you to be able to hold your own on a level that they're used to dealing with. So I like it. Yeah. I used to have a chip on my shoulder about it. Now I'm like, okay. I walk into the meeting and they're minus one already, because they're expecting something completely different.
Right. Yeah. That's a good way to look at it. Yeah. Do you feel that, like, the face tattoo is one, like, even though I have my own tattoos, I'm always still kind of like, man, something, there's got to be a little something extra twisted for you to get your face tattooed. Do you feel that way? Because, like I said, like, even though I'm an advocate for tattooing and I don't think of it like that, I still, when I see someone with a face tattoo, I'm like, ooh, that's an interesting person. Let's go talk.
So, I understand the social stigma that comes with that. I mean, it's no different than when you used the, you know, back in the 90s when you had a full sleeve, you were ostracized or at least looked at in a way that people are looking at people with facial tattoos. Although you're starting to see it toned down because it's becoming so mainstream. Yeah. I feel like I'm too pretty to have a face tattoo. So, no, in all seriousness, this just doesn't appeal to me. But I certainly have no issue with, I have half, you know, I don't have my staff, but a lot of my staff, artists, piercers, they have facial tattoos. Doesn't bother me at all. It's to each his own. Like, that's your form of expression. Great. Yeah. I'm a little, I guess, more conservative when it comes to, like, when, you know, someone has fuck written across their forehead, like that doesn't appeal to me. But you know, once again, I don't want to say you're a low life for having, it's just not what I want in my, my immediate surroundings.
Sure.
Yeah, I feel it's a way to be respectful and artistic at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, and I think that's one of the things that attracted me to tattooing is the fact that you can convert your body into a canvas of art for someone.
Sure.
And, you know, but yeah, I still am a little apprehensive, or not apprehensive. Like, I'm kind of a weirdo. And, you know, when I see something that a normal person would kind of, you know, be put off by, I kind of go towards it. And when I see people with tattoos on the face, I want to go talk to them. And I'm always very, like, open to, like, hey, so what's up? What caused you to do that? Like, because in my head, I'm like, I can never do that. That takes a whole other level of crazy to, like, get the needle in my face. Like, my poor face, it hurts. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, every tattoo I've ever had hurts.
Yeah.
So I'm not scared of the pain, but it's definitely part of the understanding before you get extensive work. Like, it comes with pain. It's just part of it.
Do you think we'll ever get to a point where maybe there's some kind of advancement in technology that it won't be as painful?
Oh, we already have. So
yeah,
not only do you have different numbing solutions, but just the tattoo machine in general, the way it hits. So, you know, when I was first introduced to the tattoo industry, you know, everything was run off of a coil, and the way the coil makes the needle move, it just seemed to hit and penetrate the skin a lot harder than the newer rotary style machines that are out right now. They hit the skin a little softer and it hurts a little bit less. The needles are sharper, so it doesn't damage the tissue as much or hurt as much, in my opinion. So yeah, I do. I think we're headed down that road.
I wonder if it'll end up being some kind of like laser tech, where you just kind of like scan your arm and now you have a tattoo forever. You know?
Guarantee that's coming.
Yeah, you think so?
Yeah.
That's cool.
And you're also going to see it with these removable inks too. So you can get a full sleeve one day and you can take it off very quickly the next.
Oh, okay.
That'd without cool. having to explode the ink in your arm and make your lymphatic system absorb it. So you're seeing advances in the different photocell technology with the light frequencies that they're able to make the ink dissolve and dissipate rather than just explode it and make it, you know, right now the laser is going into the ink cells and making it explode, and then your lymphatic system is absorbing it and trying to dissolve it, and people are not able to get all the colors out. But you're seeing these advancements in ink, in ink companies, where they're able to make these inks that are reactive to certain light frequencies, which make them dissipate. So you're seeing a whole new, the next 10 years are going to be very revolutionary in the tattoo world.
That's really cool. I did not know that. But I'm looking forward to that, because I've always wanted more tattoos, but then I'm always, you know, as I'm getting older, it's like, what's the point? When I was younger, it was cool because I was in a band and I wanted to look, you know, I wanted to have cool sleeves and all the things. But, you know, as I get older, I'm like, that seems like I might be wasting my time, because, like, what if I change my mind now? It's too late. But that's cool. I'm excited about that technology coming out. So to go back a little bit on Gray Days, you know, the EP just came out January 29th. When do you know? Do you have like a window, a time frame for the second album, or the next album? Sorry,
be some point this year. You know, we'll record. We'll probably be done. I'm guessing we'll be done mixing and mastering by June. So we'll start packaging and stuff like that. So maybe October, November, maybe. I'm not sure, to be honest, but that's my guess.
Okay, and then in the first one you guys put out, there were some guests, obviously some friends came in. I saw in the video that you guys put out, Head and Monkey were there from Korn. So is there more guests coming in for this one as well?
You're going to have to wait and see on that one.
Okay.
We have a few people that we'd like to invite down, but we're just now starting those conversations. But the list is very small, and the list is very predicated on people that Chester absolutely would have wanted to record with but never got the chance. And that's what this album, if we have guests, that will be the qualifier for the guest. Not just friends. It has to be somebody you wanted to play with.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, I appreciate you taking time out of your day. I know you're busy, you know, you're like you're at your office right now. So that's, I appreciate you taking some time to talk about this. I think it's a very important album to be putting out. I think it's important for anyone that had been working their entire lives on music to have their work put out there. Because even myself, you know, when I was in the band, just having some songs that I recorded but never released, they're just kind of sitting in a hard drive. Like, it would be a shame if those never came out. And, I appreciate what you guys are doing to put it out together and working with the family and working with the friends and trying to put something out that's of value to the fans. And, you know, to all the haters on the internet, quit bitching. Just quit.
There's not that many. Yeah, there's not that many. There's only a couple, and we just don't even pay attention to it anymore. We just, you know, either block them or just move on with our day. It's not worth it.
Yeah, man. It's funny. I only had one experience meeting Chester, and it was on a flight. And I forget what year it was, but he was sitting next to me waiting for the gate to open, and I remember sitting across from him and just like, that's got to be him. I feel like it's him. I saw the tattoos on his wrist, the flames. I'm like, that's him. That's got to be him. But I didn't want to bother him because I know how bad it is to, you know, get bothered in an airport. So I just went into my flight. And then when I sat down, he was sitting next to me. And I'm like, oh, okay.
Where were you flying?
I don't even remember. I really don't. I think I was flying to LA. I don't remember the actual, because this was like a long, this was I believe right when Hybrid Theory had come out. So it was a very long time ago. And so we sat down and we talked for a bit, and you know, I didn't bother like getting a picture or anything. I don't even think we had like good cameras on our phones at that point. You know, I was just kind of like, let me just enjoy this. And we chatted up the whole flight, and he was all super nice, man. Super, super caring and humble. And, you know, not at all like some of the rock star divas that I've met, later.
Nope, he was later. One of the nicest guys in the world, and the fame and success never changed him at all. Just did. He was a great guy.
Well, again, thank you so much. Thank you for doing what you're doing, and I look forward to the new album as well. Please, if you guys are watching or listening, pick up the Amends Stripped EP, and the Stripped aspect of it, is it, you know, mostly just acoustic work?
Yeah,
Yeah, so that's where that comes from.
You get to hear these songs in a different light, different tempos. It's really kind of a cool thing. He sounds amazing. So if you're a Chester fan, I think you'll love it.
Awesome. Awesome, guys. And then social media plugs for you guys, for the band?
Great A's, official Great A's. Great A's official. Yeah, just you can find us pretty much everywhere. And we like to put up old, cool, vintage stuff and stuff we're working on and interact with the fans as much as we can. So, yeah, jump on and follow us.
Awesome, man. Well, thanks again. Have a good rest of your day, man.
Thank you. Take care. Appreciate it. Later.